Thank you for tuning in to Share a Talk with Evangelist King. Today we're going to talk about the mind, a battlefield. And our scripture reference is coming from 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, verse 5. And it reads, "We destroy arguments and every prior obstacle to the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ." Now, the mind of man is his organ of thought. Through it, he is equipped to know, think, imagine, remember, and understand. Man's intellect, and when I say man, I'm talking about mankind. Man's intellect, reasoning, wisdom, and cleverness all pertain to the mind. Broadly speaking, the mind is the brain. Mind is a psychological term, whereas brain is a physiological term. The mind of psychology is the brain of physiology. Man's mind occupies a large place in his life because his thought easily influences his action. Before regeneration, according to the Bible, the mind of man is unusual in that it constitutes a battlefield where Satan and his evil spirits contend against the truth and against the believer. We may illustrate as follows, dear heart. Man's will and spirit are like a citadel which the evil spirit craves to capture. The open field where the battle is waged for the seizure of the citadel, C-I-T-A-D-E-L, is man's mind. Note how Paul the Apostle describes it. He says, "Though we live in the world, we are not carrying on a worldly war, for the weapons of our warfare are not worldly, but have divine power to destroy strongholds." We destroy arguments and every prior obstacle to the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. That's 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 through 5. Again, Paul is telling us that we take captive every thought to obey God. So every thought that comes into our mind, we need to capture it to the obedience of God. Now, he initially tells us of a battle, that is Paul, then where the battle is fought, and finally for what objective. This struggle pertains exclusively to man's mind, to our mind. The apostle likens man's arguments or reasoning to an enemy's strongholds. So therefore, dear hearts, when we ourselves begin to think thoughts or even allow the enemy to place thoughts in our head or in our mind that is not in agreement or according to the word of God, they are known as our arguments against God, and they are reasonings. And we need to remember that always. Apostle Paul pictures the mind as held by the enemy. It must therefore be broken into by waging war. He concludes that many rebellious thoughts are housed in these strongholds and need to be taken captive to the obedience of Christ. All this plainly shows us that the mind of man is the scene of battle where the evil spirits clash with God. See, the mind of man is the battleground or the battlefield of the enemy. It's the ground that the enemy uses to wage warfare and to clash with God if we allow the enemy to be successful in our mind. That's the reason why Paul said we need to bring every thought captive to the word of God. That's why it's very important that on a daily basis we meditate, study, and think on the word of God. By doing so, we are waging a spiritual warfare against strongholds and preventing them from seizing the ground of our mind. Scripture explains that before regeneration, the God of this world had blinded the minds of the unbeliever to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the likeness of God. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 4. This verse concurs in what the other verse just quoted said by declaring here that Satan holds onto man's mind by making it blind. Some people perhaps may consider themselves extremely wise in their ability to advance many arguments against the gospel. Others may take for granted that unbelief is due to dullness of understanding, but the truth in both cases is that the eyes of man's mind have been covered by Satan. When firmly held by Satan, the mind of man becomes hardened. Man follows the desires of body and mind as children of wrath, and so is estranged and hostile in mind, because the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. According to 2 Corinthians 3rd chapter verse 14, Ephesians 2 verse 3, Colossians 1 verse 21, Romans 8 verse 7. Now, prior to regeneration, man's intellect obstructs him from apprehending God. It is necessary for his mighty power to destroy man's arguments. This is a work which must occur at the hour of new birth, and it does happen then in the form of repentance. The original definition of repentance is none else than a change of mind. That is repentance. A change of mind. Man in his mind is at enmity with God. Therefore, God must alter man's mind if he would impart life to him. So in order for God to impart life to us, we first must repent or have a change of mind, because man's mind is an enmity with God. So God has to alter man's mind so that he can impart life to man. In his unregenerated state, man has a darkened mind. At his regeneration, it undergoes a drastic change, because it has been so united with the devil. It's vital for man to receive from God a change of mind before he can receive a new heart. Acts 11 verse 18. Because God first must give us a new mind, a change of mind, before he can give us a new heart. Now, after regeneration, but even following repentance, the believer's mind is not liberated totally from the touch of Satan. As the enemy worked through the mind in former days, so today will he work in the same manner. Paul, in writing to the Corinthian believers, confide that he was afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. 2 Corinthians 11 chapter verse 3. The apostle well recognizes that as the God of this world blinds the mind of unbelievers, so will he deceive the mind of the believers also. Even though they are saved, their life of thought is as yet unrenewed. Consequently, it remains the most strategic battleground. The mind suffers the onslaughts of the powers of darkness more than any other organ of the whole man, dear heart. We should realize that satanic spirits are directing special attention to our minds and are attacking them unrelentingly as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning. Satan did not assail Eve's heart, dear heart, first, but rather her head. Similarly, today, the evil spirit first attacked our head, not our heart, in order to have us corrupted from the simplicity and purity which is towards Christ. So if the enemy can attack your mind first to turn you against Christ, he can have your heart. They fully understand how it is the weakest point in our entire being, for it has served as their fortress before we believe, and even now is not yet entirely overthrown. Attacking the mind is the easiest avenue for the enemy to accomplish their purpose. Eve's heart was sinless, and yet she received Satan's suggested thoughts. Help us, Lord Jesus. She was beguiled through his deception into forfeiting her reasoning and tumbling into the same snare of the enemy. Jesus, help us. Let a believer accordingly be careful in his or her boast of possessing an honest and sincere heart. Be careful, dear heart. Be careful now. Remember the ground that Satan seeks to gain territory is the same ground he had before you was converted, and that was the ground of the mind. So be careful of your boasting of possessing an honest and sincere heart, for unless he or she learns how to repulse the evil spirits in their mind, he or she will continue to be tempted and deceived into losing the sovereignty of their will. Help us, Lord Jesus, help us. It is possible for a child of God to have a new life and a new heart, but be without a new head. That means a new mind. Because the mind got to be renewed daily, dear heart. With too many saints, the mind, though their heart is new, is still quite old. They still got that stinking thinking. Their heart is full of love, whereas their head is totally lacking in perception. How often the intents of the heart are utterly pure, and yet the thoughts in their head are confused. Having become saturated with a mishmash of everything, the mind lacks the most signal, essential element of all, which is spiritual insight. Countless saints genuinely love all children of God, but unfortunately their brain is stuffed with a hodgepodge of theories, opinions, suspicions, and objectives. Quite a number of God's best and most faithful children are the most narrow-minded and prejudiced field. Already have they decided what is the truth and what truth they will accept. They reject every truth because these do not blend in with their preconceived notions. Their head is not as expansive as their heart. There are other children of God whose mind can conceive no thought whatsoever. No matter how many truths have been heard, they can neither remember nor practice nor communicate them to others. These have certainly heard of Lot, yet they possess no ability to express any of it. For many years they have received truth, but not even a little can they supply for the needs of others. Perhaps they may even brag how full they are of the Holy Spirit. What creates such symptoms is an unrenewed mind. Lord Jesus, help us, Lord, help us, Jesus. The causes of the attack of the evil spirits. Why is a Christian's mental life so beset by evil spirits? This can be answered in one sentence. Believers are for the evil spirits or the devil the opportunity to attack. Let everyone clearly understand that it is possible for one's mind to be assaulted by the devil. This is confirmed by the experience of many saints. And the area primarily assailed by him is the thinking faculty. For it has a special affinity towards evil spirits. It either partially or totally has slipped out from under man's sovereignty and has come under their dictate. These powers can switch one thought on or off according to their wishes, completely disregarding the victim's ideals. Although the head is still attached to the believer, his sovereignty over it has been supplanted by another. Regardless how extensively he may protest, Lula can be corrected. Wherever anyone offers opportunity to wicked spirits, he cannot follow his own will anymore, but must be obedient to another's. When he gives ground to them in his mind, he immediately forfeits his sovereignty over it. This also bespeaks the fact that his mental faculty is now being occupied by evil spirits. Had it not been attacked by them, his will would contend to control everything he could think or stop thinking or as he will without difficulty. The most crucial factor in relation to their wicked activity is to have ground given to them. Without proper footing, they cannot operate. The amount of their activity depends on the amount of space yield to them. It is in the organ of his thought that the Christian supplies territory to evil spirit, and hence that they operate. Generally speaking, the ground in the mind which may be ceded to the enemy is of six kinds. Now we shall look at each of these at some length. Number one, an unrenewed mind. The flesh continually furnishes basis for the enemy's operations. If man's mind is not renewed after his spirit is once regenerated, he exposes a great deal of territory to the machinations of the evil spirit. While many saints do have their mentality changed at the time of repentance, nonetheless the eyes of their heart, once blind by Satan, have not yet been enlightened entirely and may still be veiled in many areas. These darkened corners are the old operation centers of the evil spirit, though greatly hindered They have not been eliminated and continue to furnish basis for the operations of the unseen hosts of wickedness. Number two, an improper mind. All sins furnish territory to the adversary. If a child of God cherishes sin in his heart, he is lending his mind to satanic spirit for their use. Since all sins derive from the dark power, he is helpless to resist these powers behind whatever sins he allows to persist in his mind. As long as sinful thoughts remain in the heart, precisely that long do the evil spirits work. All unclean, proud, unkind, and unrighteous ideals supply basis of activity to these spirits. Once God's child permits such a notion to stay, he finds it harder to resist the next time it emerges, because the powers of darkness already have secured an area in his mind. Jesus, praise your holy name. We are tearing down strongholds in the mind. Number three, misunderstanding God's truth. The Lord's people rarely are aware that every time they accept a lie from the evil spirit, they are furnishing fresh ground to the enemy. Should God's followers misconstrue or misinterpret as being natural or caused by their own selves that which the evil spirits have perpetuated upon their bodies, environments, or works, they are yielding up precious territory to them by extending their demonic deeds. A lie embrace forms the ground for further activity by the satanic elements. In misunderstanding these phenomena to be the results of their own self, they unconsciously allow these things to remain in their lives. Although this permission is gained through deceit, it nevertheless provides sufficient footing for the evil spirits to operate. That's why, dear heart, the Word of God tells us, in our getting, be sure we get understanding. Because misunderstanding is another avenue which gives the enemy ground in our mind to gain that territory and to hold on to the territory in our mind through misunderstanding of God's truth. Number four, accepting suggestions. Be careful about accepting suggestions. All suggestions are not God's will and not according to the will of God. Multiplied are the suggestions which Satan hosts plants in the mind of the Christian, especially ideas concerning his circumstances and future. They enjoy prophesying to him, foretelling what will become of him and what would happen to him. Should he be unconscious of the source of such predictions and permit these to dwell in his mind, the evil spirits at the appropriate time will work on his environment to precipitate affairs to happen as prophesied. They will make sure it comes to pass, so you can continue to believe in their suggestions. Perhaps the believer may already expect it to be so, not recognizing that everything has been arranged by the enemy powers. The latter merely put their ideal into the form of prophecy, then plant it in his head to see if he will accept it or reject it. Should the will of the believer raise no objection, no, even approve of the prophecy, the spirits of wickedness have attained a footing for enacting what they have proposed. The fulfillment of the words of fortune tellers is based entirely, dear heart, on this very principle. Number 5, a blank mind. You know, God creates man with a mind to be used. He who hears the word and understand it, Matthew 13, verse 23. God desires man to understand his word with the intellect, from whence the emotion, will, and spirit are reached. A lively head is therefore an obstacle to the work of mischievous spirits. One of their greatest aims is to lead a person's mind into a blank state. Blankness means an emptiness inside, the establishment of a true vacuum. The enemy powers employ either deception or force to transform the Christian's mental faculty into a blank entity. They realize that while his head is empty, he cannot think. He has been stripped of all reasoning and sense and will accept without question every one of their teachings, regardless of its nature or consequence. Number 6, a passive mind. Broadly speaking, an empty mind differs not too much from a passive mind. Strictly speaking, the empty head means not using it, whereas a passive one means awaiting some external force to activate it. The latter is a step beyond the former. Passivity is to refrain from moving by oneself and instead to let outside elements move one. A passive brain does not think by itself, but allows a foreign power to do the thinking for it. Passivity reduces man to a machine. The basic distinction between the operating requirements of the Holy Spirit and the wicked spirit can be summarized as follows. Number 1. All supernatural revelations, visions, or other strange occurrences which require the total cessation of the function of the mind or are attained only after it has ceased working are not of God. Number 2, all visions which arise from the Holy Spirit are conferred when the believer's mind is fully active. It necessitates the active engagement of the various functions of the mind to apprehend these visions. The endeavors of evil spirits follow exactly the opposite course. Number 3, all which flows from God agrees with God's nature and the Bible. Dear heart, praise God, thank God for the reading of his word. Remember, the mind is a battlefield. That is the ground that the enemy wants to take control over again, is the mind. Because he knows if he can get the mind where he can interject his thought, he got the heart. Dear heart, be careful. Be careful. Guard your thinking. Guard your mind. And how do you guard it? By the reading of the Word of God. The Word of God rinses, cleanses your mind. It renews your mind. The Word of God. And be careful, dear heart. Never have a passive mind, a blank mind. Be careful of how you be accepting suggestions. Be careful in misunderstanding God's word. Be careful of an improper mind and an unrenewed mind. These are the ways that Satan used to gain ground into your mind. And let me share an experience that I had when I was in my early, no, I think I was in my late teens. I was in my late teens, and the church that I attended was a small congregation. We went from house to house, and the pastor allowed ones to get up and share their thoughts on the word. Well, real or not real on the word, but share their thoughts, really. And I never did it, but he started pressuring me to do it. Because I knew I wasn't a speaker, and I had a problem. I stutter, and I never liked getting up, talking in front of people. But again, he kept pressuring me to do it, so I gave in to that pressure. And I would get up, not knowing what I was going to say. And I would get up, and the next thing I knew, I was sitting back down. And if someone would have came and asked me what I said, excuse me, I couldn't have told you what I said. But all I knew was that some of the people in the congregation liked it, and the others didn't. And the ones that didn't like it, I found out that whatever I said was exactly the things that they was involved with in doing. So in other words, it was like they were being exposed. And a lot of you probably saying, oh, that was the Holy Spirit. But continue to listen to my testimony, dear heart. So anyway, I found out. I said, okay, that works. That process works. So every time I would get up, that's what I would do. I would just, I don't know how I did it, but I would just, it was like, I just wouldn't think. And so this last time that I did that, my mother made a comment, and she stated that, she said, I can tell when the spirit gets all over Terry, because when she get up and speak, you can just see the white of her eyes. And when she said that, that did not bear witness in my heart. That was God. I cringed. Now check this out. Even though I did not know Jesus like I knew him now, but when she said those words, I cringed and I said, oh no, something wasn't right. And from that moment, from that time on, I never got up to talk anymore. Because I just felt a check in my heart that wasn't right. That wasn't of God. Something was wrong. I did not have understanding of what it was. All I knew was something wasn't right. Well, when I came to the Lord in November of 1994, and the Holy Spirit started working with me, and I started working with the Holy Spirit and submitting to him, and I started renewing my mind by reading God's word and meditating upon God's word, fellowshipping with the Lord, and just spending time with him. The Lord brought that situation back to my mind. And then also I knew that the Lord wanted to use me, because he told me I wanted to use you. He said, Tara, I want to use you in ministering my word. Well, when the Lord said that, I said this thought went out to the Lord. And the thought was, Lord Jesus, I'm fine with that, but all I ask is to let me know, is to allow me to be able to know what I say. That's all I said. Did not quite understand why I was saying that, but the Holy Spirit knew why he put those words in me to say. And again, as I continue to renew my mind in the things of God by studying God's word and spending time with the Lord, and the Holy Spirit began to teach me God's word, then I began to see why come in my heart, after my mother said those words, that I got to check something wasn't right. And then I saw why the Holy Spirit led me to say these words to the Lord. Lord, you can use me, but I want to know what I said. Dear heart, what was happening when I was in my late teens, standing ministering, what I did, I without even realizing, I blanked my mind out. And therefore, by doing that, it was a familiar spirit that was using me, and it began to prophesy to the people. And it knew every sin that every one of those people that was in that place, the sin that they committed, it was aware of it. And they thought that they had done it in secret. Well, that demon spirit exposed it. He would bring it up. So therefore, since the people didn't know it was a demon spirit, they thought it was me. The ones that was guilty got angry at me and started lashing out at me and started hating me, not realizing I did not even know what I said. It was a demon spirit. And when the Lord brought that to me, I just shook my head and I said, Lord Jesus, forgive me. And then the Lord said, Terry, the reason why the Holy Spirit had you to say what you said to me, that was your way of saying you refuse in the demon spirit to use you when you get up and minister my word, that you are putting your trust in me. Dear heart, now I'm sharing that with you because there are a lot of prophets. There are a lot of prophets that when they get up and they minister the word and they prophesy, they are not prophesying under the unction of the Holy Spirit. It is a demonic spirit, which is a familiar spirit, that is prophesying to the people. Because that demon knows exactly what you have done. It knows the thoughts that it puts in your mind, the evil thoughts that it puts in your mind. And it's telling you what it had already placed in your mind, so you can put greater trust into the false prophet, which in turn you put in greater trust into the demon. And I'm telling you this because if you are a prophet and you are up prophesying, teaching the word, and you turn around and tell me that you cannot tell me one word that you said, that is not the Holy Spirit. That is a demon spirit, a familiar spirit. Because the Holy Spirit works with you. You will be aware of your faculties. I have experienced both. I have experienced being used by a demon spirit. I have been experienced being used by the Holy Spirit, and the difference is the evil spirit take complete control over you where it blanks you out. You don't know what one word you said, but the Holy Spirit is working there with you. He's leading you into all truth. He's speaking truth for you, and it's like you standing there with another person in a conversation, but you're aware of what you're doing. You're aware of what you're saying. I may not can tell you verbatim what I said, but I give you some idea of what I said. Well, when it's a demon spirit, you can't even give them no idea because they blank you completely out. Dear heart, don't get excited when a prophet comes to you and tell you your sin, because Satan knows your sin and he will reveal your sin. Now, if that prophet don't, when they prophesy to you and they lead you to Jesus Christ, and they are aware of their faculties and what they're doing, and they pointing you to Jesus, that's different. Then it's the Holy Spirit. But I recently went to a service where this person said they're an apostle prophet. And I knew that was a demon spirit ministering to them, through them. I knew it. And after the service, the person said, no, I couldn't tell you not one word I said. And right then I knew. I said, I said to myself, that's because that was a demon spirit. And what's so funny was, when this demon spirit was ministering through this person, something had happened in that service. And so that demon through that person said, and what happened in here stays in here. Nobody should go out and say anything about it. It stays in here. Well, lo and behold, soon that person went outside, that person brought up what happened. Come on, dear heart. We better pray and ask the Lord to help us to know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. If not, demon spirit will be teaching you. Demon spirit will be prophesying to you. Demon spirit will put sickness on you and turn around and heal you and make you think that that is God's doing. So you can bow down and worship it. And how you bow down and worship the demon? By bowing down and worship the man or the woman or the instrument that is being used. So be careful how you blank your mind and have a passive mind, because the Holy Spirit works with you. He don't take complete control over you where you're not aware of your thinking faculty. He works with you. And I just felt led to share that, because so many of us, all it takes is a person who say they're a prophet and come to you and tell you something that you doing, or maybe something that you thinking, or even tell you your street address, or tell you your name, or tell you what color your house. Dear heart, demons, they know all that stuff, and they will reveal it. And you get so excited, oh, they told me my name. Oh, they knew my address. Oh, they know what color shirt I had on. Demons know all of that, and they will reveal it to those who they put themselves in. So why do you get excited with things like that? See, when the Holy Spirit reveals something, dear heart, the end result will be you submitting to Christ Jesus. Jesus being exalted and lifted up. I had a prophet one time to come to me and started prophesying. In the beginning, I have to admit that I didn't know the man was a false prophet. But later on, things happened, and I knew. I said, Lord, this man's a false prophet. So anyway, that familiar spirit in him knew that I knew that it was fake. It was false. So he come calling me up, and we're looking down at my belly area. He said, sister, he said, I see that there's a sickness. And he said, sickness. I said, uh-uh. He looked at me, and I looked at him, and I did not care who was around me. I did not receive it. I said, no. And as soon as I said no, he hushed up. See, if you don't receive, or if you reject the words of a familiar spirit through someone, they can't go any further. But if you receive them, they will prophesy to you. And if when you receive it, it will happen. Because you have given it. You have given it power to happen. You had given it permission to happen. So, dear heart, again. Now, if that man would have said, you know, the Lord had revealed to me such and such, but God said he's going to heal you. You heal what the devil meant for harm. God going to heal. He didn't say all of that. And he wasn't going to say that. Dear heart, help us, Lord Jesus, help us. Help us, Lord. Help us, Jesus. Help us. Get in the Word and stay there. The Word of God is your hiding place. Get in the Word of God daily. Submit your mind to Him. Every thought that comes in, you take it captive to the obedience of God. It's just like foods. You don't allow all kinds of sorts of foods to enter your mouth, into your taste bud. You examine it by sniffing it, looking at it. If it don't look right, you toss it away. Well, you need to start doing your thoughts like that as well. Every thought that comes in your mind, you need to analyze it in the Word of God and say, well, if this is something that Jesus would say or think, how does this agree with the Word of God? How does this thought make me feel? Does it make me dislike my brother or sister, or make me angry, or make me upset, make me miserable? Dear heart, examine your thought and be careful. Examine your thoughts and don't receive every thought from others as well, which are suggestions. So, dear heart, I want to thank you for tuning in to Share Talk with Evangelist King. And remember again now, as always, in your getting, be sure you get understanding. Shalom. Get understanding.